Well, like I'm talking to 100 people. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm Sandy Granger-Talby, president of Brevard Film and Talent. Tonight we have some awesome guests. We have Kevin O'Neill and T.L. Westgate. And that's all I'm going to tell you, because Bill Williams, one of our very active members and the moderator for tonight, is going to be telling you all about them, letting them help him tell you all about them. I have only one announcement, really. Sort of one announcement, and that is next month's meeting will also be on Zoom for sure on October 11th. And we're having Brevard County's new film commissioner, Megan Happel. And I say new because she took over from Bonnie King when she retired, but that was just as COVID hit and it got bad here and everything shut down. So we haven't really had a chance to get to know her. And we're going to let everyone that tunes in that night be able to have a moment to, you know, introduce themselves and let Megan know what they do in film. So it's time to make an impression on the film commissioner, but keep it short. We've got a lot of people usually for these things. We're going to be having live meetings again once the COVID cases get down, at least to the level it was at the beginning of the summer. We actually had just had one live meeting and that was it. So I guess I'm ready to hand it over to Bill. So Bill, I'm going to mute myself and you can take it away. I can't hear anything. Can anyone else?
Yep. No, I had a switch turned off. My bad. So the purpose of tonight's meeting is to focus our attention on the images we make when we're making a video or film production. We all know story is probably the most important aspect of the production, but the images we make, it is motion pictures. It is pictures is in there as a significant term. And this was somewhat inspired by my brother, who sent me a video clip, which I will show in a little while, that was a collection of images. And think about why those images are compelling when you're watching this thing. So to get started, let's introduce our panelists and two of our MIF favorites, Kevin O'Neill. I'll let you introduce yourself first and tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, thank you, Bill. Who was that? I just heard a train horn. I don't know if that was just me. You hearing me now? Okay. So, my background is I was an actor for 30 years. I lived in Los Angeles for 10 years. I have been a filmmaker for the last 10 years of my life. And I've worked on these films that you can see on the screen, written and directed these. Currently, I have three television series that I've written that I'm working on. One of them is being pitched in Los Angeles. And I also have 7 feature films that I've written and I'm pitching as well. So I also teach at Full Sail University. I've been there for 15 years, teaching directing to filmmakers. And glad to be here.
You're up.
Okay. Well, hello, everybody. I'm T.L. Westgate. I'm an online professor at the LA Film School. Been doing that for 3 years, teaching all sorts of classes. And much like Kevin said, you know, about 10 years ago is when I started to get my films onto the film festival circuit. And, you know, MIF has been a big part of that, being so close. I love going to MIF every year. And I teach some directing, editing courses. Being a kind of a do-it-yourself filmmaker, I had to learn how to do everything. And it's a good thing, education-wise, even if you just want to direct or want to act or be an editor, it's good to at least get a shared language for some of the other positions so that you can communicate with other people. So I've done a little bit of everything, even making the posters. I'm glad to be here as well. Thank you.
Well, I have been involved with, well, my I started my interest in film production back when I was a teenager. And as many of us, we played around with our parents' home movie cameras or whatever and tried to make something useful. And that went led to me getting involved in stage productions in high school. And unfortunately, my era when I was growing up, it was really hard to get into television production and get anywhere. So I got into engineering, but after 17 years, I couldn't resist the urge and got into video production full time. And I've had a blast since then. Maybe not a lot of money, but I've had a good time doing it. And got involved with the MIF in its second year and been heavily involved since then and obviously involved with film groups and so forth. My passion is on the production side, but I have been discovering that writing is probably even more fun and quite an interesting area to get involved with. Because that is where the story is created. And that's really the most important part. Pictures, though, can be very compelling. And that's what we're going to be talking about here. This is just a still shot from a video done by, I don't know who did it actually, but Yellow, the band, the musical group Yellow, did a song called Blender. And this is a collection of images that was somebody put together to that piece of music. So I'm going to play that and just give you an idea about thinking about images.
My ladies, please come closer. My name is Random Tux. I have the great honor and the pleasure to present you Turnex, the sum of Durex, the blender for the next millennium. This is a revolution for your kitchen. Smashed potatoes, sliced tomatoes, apple juice, blueberry, raspberry, cherries, and peaches in a fraction of a second. Turnex, the sum of Durex. The only blender which can be turned into the most powerful action trainer!
Blenders for sale, and selling to girls, they always know.
Thank you.
a smile over hips, she was changing my life. We are heading downtown in her car. Her ride is too smooth, no light for a stop. My blenders are flying. She looked in my eyes, no name for this ride. She's Christine, she's 16, I'm her slave. She is calling me Jake, she keeps me awake. Oh boy, I was ready to go.
Okay, well, switch to the next slide. Thank you, my slide machine. All right, so thinking about images, let's turn the baton over to Kevin. And Kevin, I've got some videos queued up here. If you want to play something or do something out of order, whatever, let me know and I'll switch to whatever it is and we can go with that.
Yeah, there are some things I thought of after the fact. I sent you some images in that last email, but there's some other things as well that have come up. But I think, are you going to show the reel? Is that what you want to start with?
I can show pieces and you can talk about it. And I did put those, I think I put those images up there.
Well, you know what might work well, Bill, is if you show the film Shawshank, the clip from Shawshank for me. Okay. And the reason is that's what really influenced me as a director and as a filmmaker and as a writer. And then I can kind of tag off of that into the reel. Or you can show the reel first if it's already queued up and then do the...
Well, I can do Shawshank first. I can do whatever.
Why don't you do my reel first and then do the Shawshank, and then I can kind of bounce off of what I want to say about Shawshank. I think that'd be easier.
Okay.
Yeah.
I guess I need to share. Just a minute.
You want to tell me your favorite story?
I'm sorry I was gone for a bit. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry I was gone.
Okay. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. You're gonna be okay, Daddy.
The patients have short-term memory loss, but they have great long-term. And the seniors just want to talk about their past. All you have to do is listen.
Son, this tape is for you to play when you find things that generate stress. Remember that deep breathing is a very good way to reduce the effects of stressful situations.
This is no time for a reunion. You look just like your mom.
Sometime you'll feel sad. It's okay to feel sad.
So if you want, I can go ahead and just kind of talk from this point, Bill, is that good? Okay, so let me just start by saying this. This is my most recent reel. It's a compilation of some of my work to kind of show the tone, feel, and look of the work that I do. I was in LA from 1985 to 1995. And when I was moving back to LA, back to Florida, I started writing for the first time around 1995 or 1994, somewhere around there. And I saw the movie Shawshank Redemption. And it wasn't just that it was a great story, well told with incredible actors. What it was for me is the director, Frank Darabont, actually opened our eyes to what that world is for people that are in prison for a lifetime, and then they try to fit back in, and it was impossible for them to do it. The world has changed around them. And this moment that I saw with the character, and we'll see the clip in a minute, but when I saw this scene in the movie, it just ripped my heart out, because what it showed me is humanity. It showed me, even though these are hardened criminals and they're in there for really good reasons, they're in prison for a good reason, they have to acclimate at some point. They have to be able to leave prison. And we didn't spend a lot of time. We don't prepare them to leave prison. We prepare to keep them in prison. And I'm not getting on a soapbox here. I'm just saying that that's what I got out of this story when I saw this final scene. And that is the movie that set the tone and the feel for everything I would write and direct from that point on. That's one of many, obviously. There were several others in that same vein that had that same feel. But that's the movie that set it for me. So if you want to play that, then we can kind of go from there.
Shawshank, the final scene? You're muted. Was that the one you wanted, Kevin? Shawshank final scene?
Yeah, sorry. Yes, that's the one.
Okay, and I do have two still images that you sent, so I've got them ready to go.
Okay.
So. Okay.
Dear fellas, I can't believe how fast things move on the outside. I saw an automobile once when I was a kid, but now they're everywhere. The world went and got itself in a big damn hurry. Got me into this halfway house called the Brewer, and a job bagging groceries at the foodway. It's hard work, and I try to keep up, but my hands hurt most of the time.
Make sure your man double bags. Last time he didn't double bag, and the bottom near came out.
Make sure you double bag, like the lady says. Understand?
Yes, sir. Surely will.
I don't think the store manager likes me very much. Sometimes after work, I go to the park and feed the birds. I keep thinking Jake might just show up and say hello, but he never does. I hope wherever he is, he's doing okay and making new friends. I have trouble sleeping at night. I have bad dreams like I'm falling. I wake up scared. Sometimes it takes me a while to remember where I am. Maybe I should get me a gun and rob the foodway so they'd send me home. I could shoot the manager while I was at it, sort of like a bonus. I guess I'm too old for that sort of nonsense anymore. I don't like it here. I'm tired of being afraid all the time. I've decided not to stay. I doubt they'll kick up any fuss. Not for an old crook like me.
So for me, you know, we're talking tonight about images and the power of images. And there's so much, you know, I didn't start directing until it was 10 years ago. And I knew a lot about acting. So for me, the directing aspect wasn't as big a challenge. But like TJ said earlier, we really do need to know more about everything. I've learned about cinematography. I've learned about color correction. I've learned about editing. I've learned about music, the simplicity of music picking. And what I've really realized and come to realize is that the work needs to be seamless. If I sit in a movie theater and I pay attention to the acting, or I pay attention to the cinematography, or I pay attention to the editing, or I pay it to anything, if it comes up and I notice that's an edit, or that's a musical cue misplaced, or I'm even registering it. If you really thought about it, if you really think about it, that scene we just watched, it was hard to really tell. The music was so blended into what we were feeling. And since we're talking imagery, you know, there's a lot of images you could have taken out of there and made a painting of that were just beautiful. I think the biggest thing is when we're thinking about and we're in pre-production, the thing I've learned over the 10 years is, what are we trying to say? What should the audience walk away with? You know, I know conventions is always, what's the takeaway? What am I supposed to learn from this event? And what am I supposed to feel? There's two images that I have that Bill has that are from Man in the Woods. And it should be, I don't think you can, I don't know if you can show them at the same time, but it doesn't matter. You can just show one.
You want first.
Yeah, yeah. Show me the brown one with the, not the brown one, the one in the cabin, if you can figure it. It's cabin or in the hospital, it's one or two.
Okay.
Okay, so when I wrote this, I wrote it because of my father. This is basically based on my father in 2017. He passed away from early stages of Alzheimer's. He never got full Alzheimer's, and thank God for that, because we never wanted to see him when he couldn't remember us at all. But I remember how sharp his long-term memory was and how bad his short-term was. He could remember things from the 1940s in detail, but if you asked him where his coffee cup that was sitting right next to him, he couldn't find it. And so I was being a son, I have four sisters, and we just took care of my father. We all took a weekend each over those last 2 years of his life, and we just cared for him. But also as a writer, I was observant. I was aware of what was going on, never thinking I'd write a film, but then I did. And in this storytelling here, what I wanted to do was capture two things. Number one, where is the man, okay? Where is he really? And then where is he in his mind? Where the man is in his mind is in the cabin that he loves. It's where it's a sense of comfort. It's where he feels the safest. And where he really is in a hospital. And so when I got together, because we're talking about imagery, when I got together with my art department and I got together with my director of photography, I wanted a very warm tone, feeling to this. I wanted the clothing to be very warm. The wardrobe, the set was already what it was, but what we brought in is, if you look around, there's brown chairs, there's tan tablecloths, there's, very, very subtle, warm feeling clothing and also set. And then if you go to the other one, Bill, the hospital, it's very reflective. It's very blue, cold. And what it does for us as an audience is it jars us. In this scene, in this final scene in Man in the Woods, which we are going to show, I just want you to, right? We are going to show that. Is that correct? Yeah. So in this scene that we're going to show, what I want you to understand is when I wrote this, it was an idea in my head. And when I went to my director of photography, and I went to my editor, and he's like, boy, that's going to be tricky. Because we shot these scenes completely in separate times. The cabin we had was out of, it's actually where we shot our film Undertaking. It was a 6,000 acre ranch. We shot it 3 or 4 days before we shot this scene. And the problem is that the actors, when you're shooting this, they're moving. And my DP wanted to use handheld because he wanted that feeling of disjoint tension in the scene. And so he had to make sure that he captured it in focus when they would move. And then the actors had to duplicate identically what they did here as they did in the cabin, identical. And even though I have a great script supervisor, for an actor to remember exactly what move they made, where they looked, what they did, how they felt emotionally, identical, was very tricky. And so the look worked. We could see that. What we didn't know is, will it cut together so that we as an audience get into the head of the man? That was what I wanted in the scene. I wanted you as an audience member, and I think a lot of you may have seen this film, but I wanted you to know that this little boy inside is actually what he really thinks he is. He still is this little boy. And so I tricked the audience in the beginning to think it's a story about a little boy, and then boom, we flip it. And it's actually not, it's actually the man, and we see him for the first time. And then he's really in the cabin, but he's not, he's actually in the hospital. And when I gave it to my editor, I said, can you cut this? Let's make this the first thing you cut of the film, because if it doesn't work, then all I wanna do is just cut from the cabin to the hospital and never cut again, because it's gonna look like a mess. And when he started cutting it, he came back and said, Kevin, it actually works. And you'll see where we see his perspective is her in the cabin, because that's where he thinks she is. And we see her perspective of him in the hospital, but it kind of jumps around from the hospital to the cabin. So because this theme is really about imagery and what we do and how we feel, I think this scene will kind of help set up that. I want you to be, as an audience member, I want you to feel disoriented. But we're going to use one word. I want you to feel disoriented as he feels. And then you've stepped into the shoes of the man with Alzheimer's. So yeah, if you want to play that, then we can talk about it.
Okay.
Lost track of time.
Did you see any birds?
With this. That boy knocked on the door. He has asthma. I gave him one of my cartridges.
Okay.
No, he's right there. He's right there. The little boy is right there.
Okay.
Okay.
It's okay.
It's okay. It's okay. I want to find my way home. What happened? It's not broken. It's not broken. Why is it not broken?
It's okay. It's very old.
My father gave it to me.
Okay. No, it's okay. You're gonna be okay, Daddy. You're gonna be okay. It's gonna be okay. It's okay.
So if I did my job as we did our jobs as filmmakers, then you should feel that same thing. Unfortunately, a lot of people have our age have people have family members that are going through this. They're going through Alzheimer's and early stages of dementia. So it's not uncommon. And for most people, they get it. They get that was the objective, is to make people, you know, feel that for a moment. And that's what I think I felt when I watched Shawshank, the final scene, is that I felt like I understood this man, you know, despite whatever he did in his life, I understood him, and I felt the loneliness. There's a scene when he's on the bus and he's gripping a hold with a death grip on that bar, and he's petrified. It's not the bus, it's where he's going. And he knows where he's going, and he doesn't know what's going to happen and how he's going to get back into society. That moment there is what really rivets me to watching his performance. So if anybody has questions, I can answer questions, because I know that.
Well, let's hold them to the end so that we can get everybody through. And
okay,
we're going to try and end at 7:30 with our general presentation and then open it up for Q&A.
Got you.
Bill, can the ones just for him go now, because he said he might have to check out early?
Yeah, we'll be done by 7:30. I'm on top of it.
Okay.
Because I'm the last one, so I can make mine whatever length it needs to be.
Okay.
I'm in control. but that was when we're thinking about images here, I thought it was profoundly effective, the switching back and forth between the two environments. So when you're thinking about images, it's more than just the image, but it's how you piece it all together. And I thought that was brilliantly done. That was highly effective. I liked it. So TL, we'll pass the baton to you, and I can cue up any video that we've got in the collection here, or turn the screen over to you and you can show something.
Well, jumping in, kind of teeing off of what Kevin was talking about, if you let me share my screen, I can show you a little something here. Okay. This is from a film that played at MIFF in 2014 or 15, maybe 16. Normally, you know, I my genre, my wheelhouse is comedy, but every once in a while I branch out. And this is from a drama that we made back then called Resolution. And what Kevin was talking about with the colors is very important in filmmaking, especially in short films. If you're not familiar with the term semiotics, it's kind of the symbolism in films. And through, you know, artful placement, you can really get the audience up to speed on characters and relationships in a short film, which is really important because you don't have a lot of time. If you think of a short film as basically the final scene of a feature film, you have to give the audience enough information right at the start of the short film to know the relationships and the story and what's going on. And then you give them the ending. So can I share? Okay. Ah, here, we're sharing. Sharing is caring. I've got do you see this menu bar? Oh, let me move. There we go. So this is from Resolution. And here's my character, bland, cream colored shirt, khakis, drinking white wine. This is a New Year's Eve party. And here on the left is my wife and another couple that we're having New Year's Eve with. Notice they're all in black. They all have red wine. We use that to help the audience separate, not only physically in this shot, but to differentiate me from them. They're all, he's got a red ring, red wine, red lipstick, red earrings, black clothing. I'm coming over in my, cream colored shirt and khakis and white wine. My wife's got the red earrings, the red lipstick, the black dress. So this is a way to just really kind of split my character from them. I'm not a part of the in crowd. And, this film's a couple years old. Basically, I hired a private investigator to find out that the wife's cheating on me. So, at the end, I do whatever anybody would do and I kill them all. But through the use of semiotics and the strategic use of colors, here, I'll even stop now. Oh, I stopped sharing. Oh, stop share. You can really help get the audience up to speed real quick. Another film that, and not only do you need to plan this out, because keep in mind, I'm sure a lot of people here are filmmakers as well. And we as the low to no budget filmmakers, you have to use your house. You have to have your characters, say, bring your own clothing. But in Hollywood, they build sets. And when you build a set, you get to pick the drapes, the curtains, the wallpaper, the carpet, the couch, everything, all the coloring. It motivates the mood for that entire scene. So it's very purposeful. And that will really help you as a filmmaker to up your game, so to speak. Another thing we did with For Luck, which played a couple years ago, all the character, we kind of embedded some in jokes into the script. If you pay attention and you had a good hold of 70s soft rock artists, because all of the character names were soft rock artists from the 70s, and most of them referenced songs from the 70s throughout the film. So it's a little, it's an extra layer of humor. If you get it, if you don't get it, if you don't catch on to it, it doesn't harm the filmmaking experience at all. You just don't know that there was a joke there. But if you catch on, there's some little in jokes, and you can certainly do that at the writing stage of what you do as well. Don't just make a story. See if you can give it some depth and some layers, some onion skin, so to speak. I don't know if you want to keep talking about. You have a clip of Raiders of the Lost Ark. We could go into that too.
Well, I have three clips, the bar fight, the sword fight, and the idol grab.
Yeah, well, see, to me, this was Raiders of the Lost. I saw Star Wars in the back of my mom's Pinto at a drive-in in 1977. So that was kind of, seminal moment for me. But I think Raiders for me was the film that just blew my mind, because at the time I saw the ads and I was like, this is a movie about some guy digging a hole in the desert. I didn't know what the movie was about. I didn't even want to see it. And my grandparents took me to see it, and I was like, wow, that's what this is about. And, you know, that's that Steven Spielberg film style just really grabbed hold of me. And things like the bar fight show you the importance of choreography, which we all a lot of times think of as dancing, but it's all the movement of the actors and the fights and getting them in place for the next line, for the next action. And it was balletic to me to see something like that and start to absorb not just the fun of films, but what goes into making a film. If you want to show that real quick.
I will share a screen and make that happen.
Good evening, Fräulein.
The bar is closed.
We are not thirsty.
What do you want?
The same thing your friend Dr. Jones wanted. Surely he told you there would be other interested parties.
He must have slipped his mind.
The man is nefarious. I hope for your sake he has not yet acquired it.
Why, are you willing to offer more?
Oh, almost certainly. Do you still have it?
No. But I know where it is. Hey, how about a drink for you and your men?
Your fire is dying here. Why don't you tell me where the piece is right now?
Listen, Aramac. I don't know what kind of people you're used to dealing with. Nobody tells me what to do in my place.
Fräulein Ravenwood. Let me show you what I am used to. Nick! Ha!
Take your hands off me! Take your lousy hands off! Wait, I can be reasonable.
That time is past.
You don't need that. Wait. I'll tell you everything.
Yes, I know you will.
Let her go.
Shoot them both.
Thank you.
medallion! Will Jones, these Javins were gotten out of show a lady a good time!
Why, you're something!
Yeah, I'll tell you what! Until I get back my $5,000, you're gonna get more than you bargained for! I'm your goddamn partner!
I will make a comment before TL. I was listening to the audio pretty much in detail. There was some pretty fancy audio editing there too.
Oh yeah. I mean, that era, Star Wars and the Spielberg era, just not only elevated filmmaking, but audio engineering. I mean, all the sound effects that they came up with are just iconic. And those camera moves, every frame of that scene is just, you could do a study on it. It's awesome. I love it.
Well, we can continue in our Q&A part to cover some things that you were just talking about. To keep ourselves on track, sure. I'd like to grab a little time here. I'm going to fast forward to a clip. This is a focus more on the motion of an image. Ben, this was a combination of motion that was part of when we shot and part of when we edited, because motion was put in added also when we edited this piece. So think about motion when you're creating your images, as far as you need a motivated reason to have motion. You can't just put motion for the sake of motion. At least you shouldn't, in my opinion. Some people do, and you'll see just unmotivated motion. NYPD Blue seemed to have a lot of unmotivated motion. Drove me nuts. Couldn't watch the show because it had so much unmotivated motion, which they toned down in the later seasons, but the early seasons were kind of chaotic. So here is just a short clip we did for a promotion for Screenwriters of Brevard, written by Tom Loomis, incidentally.
Behind me is a man working tirelessly on a story for a film. He has the idea. He doesn't have direction. Perhaps you are like him, wanting to tell your story in a well-written screenplay. The question is, will you get help from the Screenwriters of Brevard?
So that piece there not only had motion in it, but there was, if you notice, there was that bright light, the green light that was over the desk, was kind of defining the bright spot on the screen. And I don't have a clip of it, but Star Trek, Deep Space Nine, if you watch that, and this is done in a lot of movies, will have, I think it's a very darkly lit environment. And what they'll have is some brighter element in there, a light in the background, a light in the foreground, something that defines the white point, sort of the bright point. And that makes it, the rest of the scene, not look so muddy and underexposed. It kind of makes everything look natural. And that's what we tried to do here, is to try and really focus the attention on that writer and the issue that he had. All right, the next piece I'd like to show is it's a trailer, sort of. It's a new trailer from the Dick Tracy movie, which was now, I think, 31 years old. This movie really caught my attention because of its use of comic strip type colors. It was very stylized. So this is very much about the art direction in this movie. And there's and that's common in, of course, any movie, any high-end movie is going to have art direction and costuming and all those elements that really make visual images compelling. But this was very different, very out of the box for the time, and something that I really liked. I really liked the look of this movie.
We got a problem with organization. We're all split up. While we're divided, the cops can keep us under control. But together, we will own this town. Meet Dick Tracy, a servant of the people.
I think Lips Manless is dead. I want you to tell me who killed him.
Aren't you gonna frisk me?
You know, it's legal for me to take you down to the station and sweat it out of you under the lights.
I sweat a lot better in the dark.
Whose side are you on?
The side I'm always on. Mine.
Dick Tracy. Calling Dick Tracy.
I'm on my way.
You can't do this, Tracy. The DA will say you're badgering witnesses.
I want Dick Tracy dead!
Maybe you want to look before you leap, huh?
Crazy, what's up?
You get behind me, we all pop. You challenge me, we all go down.
Okay, boys, let's go.
So that certainly wasn't natural colors, but they were compelling colors. It was mentioned earlier that you don't want to take away from the story. You don't want whatever you're doing to distract from the story, but enhance the story. And this is a comic book story. They used comic book colors, comic book caricatures of people, and I found it very compelling. But there are times where you want things to look very natural. This is a still frame from a production I did for a friend of mine. I was DP. This is not my creation. I was just the DP on this job. And this is Dracula versus the Ripper. And so here is an example of a combination of costumes, the environment. This was actually shot in a bar in downtown Cocoa. We took over the place for an afternoon and shot this scene there. And of course, lighting. And this is supposed to look like a 1800s European bar. And I think we accomplished that. And it had a look that I really found appealing. And it was trying to create a real environment. Again, kind of darkly lit with some highlights to make it look like everything was in balance. Ah, oh, this shot here, this is the oldest thing you're going to see. And let me tell you a little background about this. Talk about planning ahead. We were talking about earlier about planning ahead, plan your shots. Well, back in my fantasy of dreaming someday that I might make a movie, I envisioned a scene from a movie back in the 1970s. You're about to see it, by the way. And but I had no place to do it. I had no reason to do it. At the time, I'm working as an engineer. And So back in the late 70s, I built a house and I envisioned this particular scene when I built the house. But again, I'm an engineer. I'm not working in making movies. Then in 1991, I built a camera jib. I was in the video business then. And the result was this scene was created for a movie called, a friend of mine did for, called Scary Stories for Kids.
Wake up. We got some mojo magicking to do. Fancy running into you now, Filigree, about that change we was talking about.
So, message there is think about motion, think about lighting, think about fogging a room, think about your actors, makeup, costumes, all those things go into making an image and have fun with it. Be as creative as you want, because it is a fun business. If you're doing it to make money, yikes. I've been trying for 33 years to make money in this business. And yeah, I'm hanging in there, but I'm not getting rich. But it is fun. And so I think we can open it up now for discussion and questions, and everybody can unmute themselves. And let me get my slideshow out of my way. And so, does anybody have any questions? Anything? Kevin has to leave in a few minutes, so we have him until about 7:45. So if you've got questions with Kevin, let's do them first. And
I have a question for Kevin.
John.
Sorry, Kevin. I feel I have to raise my hand. I don't know.
No, you just speak up. Anybody speak up? This is pretty informal.
So Kevin, I was actually wondering on your film, did you have anything to like actually like show the actors, or actually just for camera reference for like positioning of the shots and everything and matching angles? Did you have something there? Like, I don't know what thing you filmed first, but like, you know, did you have something there to, you know, give yourself reference, give them reference and everything like that?
Well, when we did the, I'm assuming you're talking about Man in the Woods. When we did Man in the Woods, we did, I let them do what they do. I didn't choreograph it. Basically, we let them go through this. The way I work, in essence, is I get on set while my crew is setting up, and I start rehearsing with the talent. And then my DP has gotten very familiar with me, Ryan. He starts to watch me and watch what's going on with the actors. And then he starts to construct his shots based on that. We've got a shot list, but the thing about shot lists are they're wonderful because you know how long it takes your day to, how long your day will be, but you can't tell until you get into the environment and you allow the actors to just kind of be who they're going to be in that moment. You never know what they're going to want to do. So once we get going there, that's where we start to lock the shots as far as how they will do it. So then we go to the next shot, which was from the cabin to the hospital. I tell the actors, I go, okay, guys, here's basically what's going on from the last time. The last time we shot this is basically the idea is that, you know, now, because it's not even close to the same place, that's where the little boy is in your mind. This is, you know, you and your daughter right here, you know, just kind of get them oriented. Because I think that's the question you're asking, John, is you're getting them oriented as to what was it before. Do I show them shots? No, I try to avoid that. I'll tell you why. Actors, and I was an actor for 30 years. They get funny when they see themselves, especially if they get like an ugly cry or they get it, you know what I mean? I've literally had actresses go, oh God, you're not going to use that, are you? You know what I mean? And I'm like, I love that.
I fully understand that because yeah, I've done film work and that's the most annoying thing with actors doing that.
Yeah, it's keeping them away. I just call it keeping them away from the monitor. You know, don't let them wander over to the monitor because they here's the thing. It's not whether they see themselves and ask if they change. They will change. They will go back to the camera and they will now change what they did. Whereas that becomes an issue is if they did something in this movie at the cabin and they don't want to do it anymore because they've seen it, now I'm in trouble because they can literally change their performance. So that becomes the issue. And, you know, it's just a policy of mine. I just don't really let actors come around and see, but I don't mind saying to them, look, when we were in the cabin, this is where you were. This is where this was. This is where the nurse was and got up and walked away. All of that stuff from the hospital. So they'd get, again, I think oriented is the biggest word I would use.
Cool. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? I muted everybody so that we don't have interference in the recording. So.
Kevin.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Hi, Carol.
Hi. How are you?
I'm good.
Yeah, I was just thinking, I don't know how to say this, but if you ever want to do anything like a spinoff from Shawshank, for example, mm-hmm. I sadly have personal experience with a family member that passed who was Brooks.
Oh, really? Real life?
In real life.
Wow.
Yeah, so I have a lot of knowledge, a lot, years and years of knowledge about people like Brooks.
Well, the thing that you want to do, Carol, are you a screenwriter?
No, I'm an actress.
Oh, you're an actress, okay.
Yeah.
The thing you want to do is you want to, I'm writing a script right now and I was telling my friend about it and he literally goes, dude, that's E.T. He goes, you're telling me E.T. And I went, what? He goes, yeah, the light in the chest. What are you thinking, man? That's E.T. And I went, oh God. I literally blanked on that. What he said is it can't have a whiff of any of those stories. Starman, he went down the list. And it's about aliens and I'm not gonna get into it. But my point is that what you wanna do, Carol, is you wanna figure out the angle that's different than that. In other words, Brooks's scene is not only, it's indelible. In our minds, we can't take that out of our minds. So it can't be anything even remotely close to that. But, you know, the way to, because look, no movie's original anymore. I know you guys have heard this. No movie's original. Every movie has been made. What we do is we branch off and we make it our own by taking our own angle on that same story. We basically just find another way of telling the same story in our way. So with something like that, Carol, you could figure out, you know, does it have to be, you know, him coming home? Could it be, because we know this prison story, what is it that makes it a little more unique? You know, I would, since you know, I'm assuming this person has passed.
Yeah.
Okay. So, you know, the people you want to talk to are the ones that really knew his story and start getting into that, because it could be an incredible story.
That would be me.
That would be you. Okay. Well, you know what? You don't have to be a writer. You've got writers in this room. I know that for a fact.
Right. And that's why I'm kind of coming out with this.
Yeah, it's a great idea. When you know, look, this is what I preach at Full Sail, because I teach writing, directing. I teach a lot of things. And one of the things I tell my students is don't go and try to recreate something original.
Right.
Write what you know. I have a lot of students that are ex-military, ex-police officers, they've got PTSD, they got all this stuff. I go, write what you know. And right. You have a story that's yours. And, you know, Brooks is not the main thrust of Shawshank at all. It's a side story. It's a B story of the main A story, which we all know very, very well. And your story could become the A story. You know what I mean? You could make that. And you could make it a very powerful short film as well. So I would get with one of the writers in here. You guys have a group. You have a really great opportunity. All of the features, I've written 7 features. All of the features that I have written personally, I get in front of a group of people and I bring in a bunch of actors, really good actors who are right for the roles. And we do a reading. You could do that on Zoom with your, you know, get a writer and then do a reading of this. and then start to manufacture it. I don't know what BFAT does, but I would assume that you, I know at one point when I used to go to the MIF festivals, there was always a production that you guys did, that you did three of them. I think you do variations of the same story, right? You, this is our input and this is our take on that same story. I don't know why this couldn't be something that you start to work together on and do, because what are you doing right now? What are we all doing right now? You know, trying to
have a little infomercial Saturday, but no, I don't have much.
Yeah, that's the thing
going on right now.
Yeah, there's not a lot going on. So take advantage of the time, the downtime. I wrote a complete series with an LA writer called Gone Dark that I came up with I created the project. So, but we've literally wrote 9 episodes from the time the pandemic started till literally 3 months ago. We never stopped. We now have it worked. We got it shopped in LA right now with directors. My point is that we made a decision. We're not sitting around doing nothing. We're going to take advantage of it. And we don't know how much longer we have with this. You know, we don't know. I mean, we all want to believe that it's going to end in 3 months, but I thought that when we first started this, I thought it was going to be over in 3 months. So take advantage of the downtime, Carol. Start working with somebody. Again, there's writers in this room. Start working with someone and start developing, you know, do the short and then use your short as the pitch for your feature. I've got several shorts that I pitch for my feature versions. That's another thing you could take advantage of. And you have all this talent in the room, and I don't even think this represents everyone. I think there's a lot more people. And if you all got together and collaborated and built this story, you just gotta, you know what? I'm really good at pitching people ideas. My way of getting people to do it is sitting in the room face to face with them. And by the time they leave, I've got them convinced to do it. You just have to figure out, why do we want to spend time on this? Because you will spend, I tell my students, you're gonna spend 3 years on a short film. You're gonna spend pre-production, writing the script, pre-production, casting, production, then you're going to do post-production, then you're going to do festivals for at least a year. That's the goal. So 2 years of all the pre-production, post-production, shooting, and then you better love this story, period. You better deeply love the story, because I'm going to tell you, there's times when I've gotten almost through with the festivals, and like, I don't even know why I wrote this. I don't even like this story anymore, you know? And I know TL's been through that, you know, that I saw him just laugh. I mean, anybody who's spent a long time at this knows the ones that you started and you get halfway through and you're like, I don't even know why I pitched this thing, you know? So, but you know, if it's a great story, that's where everything starts. Bill said it in the beginning. It's where it's a story first, everything second. If you don't have a story, then no one's gonna jump on board. No one's gonna get on board. I got Eddie Jemison, Oceans 11, 12, 13 to do my film Undertaken because he loved my 10-minute script. That's why he did it. It had nothing to do with me, zero to do with me, you know. And then when he looked at my work afterwards, he's like, yeah, I like your work, and yeah, I'll work with you. But you know, if you've got a story, that's half the battle.
Oh, I've got a story. And the guy wasn't a crook.
And he wasn't a crook. Well, if I were you, I would sit down and just start journaling everything you know, start doing interviews if you need to fill in holes, because even though you might know the story, you might not know everything, right? And just start journaling it and getting it out, record it on the recordings, however you have to do it, just to get that story in a nutshell where you have enough to know where you want to go with it. And then there's a great book called Save the Cat. If you ever want to, if you don't want somebody to write it, read Save the Cat, because it tells you exactly how to break down. Okay, I know, because I don't want to sound like I'm just making this up. This is my copy right here. And it's all yellowed in. You can see all the yellowed in. I go back to this book every single time. This is the greatest book ever written on screenwriting, because it literally gives you everything you need to know. Every single act, it gives you how do you open the film, the opening image, which draws us in. Everything's in it. So that if you don't want to use a writer, go do that yourself. You could write it.
I could. The story needs to be told. And I've thought about this for years and years and years, you know, how to have it told.
Mm-hmm.
So there I thought tonight's the perfect night to mention that.
Yeah.
Well, especially with stories that need to be told, you could even start off before you write a narrative script. You could do this as a mini documentary. through interviews and telling of stories just to get it down pat and maybe develop a script out of that, but at least you have started.
And you know what, can I just tag off of what TL just said? Go get that stuff now, because you know what, if there's videos, if there's pictures, who knows where that stuff ends up one day. It could end up in the trash. And not that people would deliberately do that, they just get rid of things after time goes by, you know. Go get, collect all of that, because you know that is the easiest way. Then you've got an editor in this group, I'm sure, that would sit together and possibly construct even if you did a little less than 10 minute documentary to tell the story. Someone out there might go, hey, is this a true story? Yes, it is. Hey, how?
Oh, it's a true story. And I once had all the records from Marianna Boy's home, which maybe you heard of, maybe not. It's been on the news. It's been on 2020. It's been on so many shows over the years. It's a real boy's home up in the Panhandle, and they call it the White House. You ought to Google it and read about it. So the young boy came from there. And
whose relative is this? Yours?
Mine. Mm-hmm.
Who's he related to? Like, who's his mother? Who's his father? All of that.
They died.
No. I understand. But who are the? Is it your grandfather?
It was the man I married, and I didn't know him well. It's my daughter's father, and I didn't know him well, and he was a sweetheart, and I had heard his story. He got in trouble when he was 15, and I heard his story, and I felt bad for him, and I wanted to know more about it, so I wrote to the boys' home, which I think still exists. I know the building's still there, and I know you can search the internet and find out a lot about it, and so I sent for his records, and they sent me all of his records. So I know it's a true story. And then I lived it, and he couldn't cope. And,
okay. And Carol,
anyway, I don't want to give the whole story away, but.
Yeah, Carol, I think we're getting a little off topic on images here. I mean, it's an interesting concept and worth pursuing, but before we lose Kevin, I want to ask, well, we got 2 minutes. I'm going to stick to what I said. I've got a question on how you go about collaborating to create the effects, the images, the look that you're going for. Obviously, the director is involved. And how does that progress? How do you pull that together?
There's actually an amazing software right now that I use called Shot Deck that I found out about last year, which is brilliant. It's a searchable site that you can go in and actually, and I got it because it was for filmmakers initially as a beta testing, and now you can pay for it. And I paid, I think, $64 a year. Best money you could ever buy. The reason is this. I know in my head a lot of times what it looks like, but how do I convey that? So what I do is I go in and search these images, and I can literally go in and go, I want a high angle of a man in a empty garage. I want a low angle of a man in a gas station. I want to, you know, and then I find these images, but then I also look for color because color affects mood. And I also look for angles because of angles affect mood. And then I look, and it doesn't matter if it's not the same actor all the way through. I construct the images that tell a story. Then I take that to my director of photography and I say, hey, this is it. And then he looks at it and goes, okay, you need this kind of light. You need this kind of lens. You're going to need an anamorphic lens. You're going to need, you know, and he goes down the list and says, this is what we need. And then I think about, do we have that kind of money? You know what I mean? Do we have the money to get that? Because those are very, certain lenses are extremely expensive to rent, depending on what they are. Cameras, obviously I can get cameras from Full Sail, but you know, even then I'm not guaranteed that if somebody's using them, I can't get them. Now the students come first. So there's a lot of things that go into the visual before we start to construct how we're going to put it together. So I usually come in with my visual and then I give it to my DP and then he comes back with his visuals. And then together we construct how we're going to make this all, you know, come together at the end. A lot of conversations, Bill, to be honest with you. with art directors. We do have art directors that come on that help us, and that helps a lot. I've got an editor from LA that I use that will start talking to me about the visuals in pre-production. He's talking about post-production, which I've never done that before. Yeah, he wants to know what the flow is going to be from beginning to end, and what we're going to be shooting, who's going to be given the deliverables. All of that comes into conversation. I don't even know if I answered your question.
Yeah, well, no, that was a big part of it, because that is something that I've always had a challenge doing, is communicating how to do it without storyboards, because my storyboards are terrible. But that is certainly an answer there. There was a question, the name of the book that you mentioned was Save the Cat. Somebody typed Save in the Cat.
And it's by Blake Snyder. You can see that. And you can get it on Amazon. I don't know about you, but I like to buy things on Amazon that's used, because then I can see people's notes, which I love. They put all the secrets in the world in these books. And then the other thing was that I mentioned, which is Shot Deck. I don't know if anybody asked that, but Shot Deck is something else that you may want to look at to get imagery. I've literally put 4 pitch decks together just with Shot Deck, not shooting anything of our own. A lot of people will shoot their own imagery, but we just use that because it's very cheap.
Considering my terrible skills at storyboarding, I wrote that down right away.
You're going to love that. Deeply going to love it. It's fantastic.
All right. Well, Kevin, I know we said we'd let you go at 7:45. It's 7:47, but you took up that time. I didn't do it.
That's usually me. I'm usually the one. But thank you all for having me. Thank you very much. I enjoyed being here. TL, good seeing you. And Bill and Sandy and everybody in the team, thank you so much.
Thank you very much for coming.
You're welcome. Enjoy the meeting. Bye, guys.
And the Myth coming up December 2nd, 3rd, and 4th.
Yes, thank you for saying that. Yes. Bye, guys.
Okay. Bye. Thank you very much, Kevin. All right. So we're open for discussion further with TL or anybody in the group. If there are any more questions, anything else you'd like to ask? And I guess
Shadows and Raiders of Lost Ark.
Yeah. I want to ask you the same question I just asked Kevin, is how you organize and communicate with the group as far as planning shots.
Well, for as much pre-pro as you can do with Shot Deck or just scribbling things out, coming up with color swatches, making a mood board, all that is going to help when you shoot. But always be open while you're shooting. Somebody may come up with a suggestion and say, how about if we shot over here instead? As long as we get what is in the script, I'm open to say, let's try that too. And then when I'm editing, I'll see which works better. Because I've had some great moments in my films that weren't necessarily a part of any script or notes ahead of time. It's just something that we came up with on the fly. So for all the work you can do ahead of time, that may not be the best result. So always be open to something from an actor, especially something from your cinematographer. Be open to possibilities, especially if you are going on a location that you're not really familiar with, you secured, and then when you get there, you're like, wow, this window is amazing with the light coming in right now. Let's shoot over here instead. So definitely preparation is always preferred, but be open.
Yeah, the 6 P's. Prior planning prevents piss poor performance. So anybody else have anything?
Yeah, I have a question. I don't know why I'm raising my hand again. TL, I've seen several of your films, The Myths and stuff, and they're funny. You're a funny guy. And I was just wondering, because when I think about funny stuff or write little notes down and stuff like that for films and ideas and stuff, I seem to sort of construct sort of a, I guess you could say, connect the dots of funny things, jokes and stuff like that. Do you kind of construct your scripts around all these key jokes and then kind of string it along to have an actual good narrative? Or do you just have an idea, a plot, and just follow through with it?
Yeah, there's 2 ways to go about it. Either you come up with your protagonists and tell their story, or, you know, especially for a short comedy, a lot of my inspiration comes from just something funny that I think of, like, so Tech Squad back there, I think that was my first film at Myth. I don't know if it was a dream or a weird random thought. I had this idea of it would be funny if for some reason some guy was chained up and another guy had to take off his pants. And when guys take off their pants, they do it normally. So the only way he could think of to help this guy take off his pants is to get behind him and put his arms out in front. So I don't know, I just thought that might make for something funny. But then you think, well, why the hell would they be in this situation to begin with? Well, why would the guy be chained up? Maybe they're cops, maybe there's a bomb, you know, and you kind of work outward from that one scene. And I've seen other films where I just know, even though I haven't talked to whoever made the film, I'm like, that right there was the start of this film. I guarantee you that's the first thing they thought of. And then they thought, how can I get these characters into that position? So you don't have to have, you know, chronologically, and especially you cannot write from the start to the end. You cannot say, well, I'm gonna have a detective and a damsel in distress walks into his office. Okay, no, you have to work backwards. You have to have the crime solved and figure out how to reveal those layers to get to the end. So you have to write backwards in that sense. But if it's, especially for comedy stuff, sometimes it's just a funny scene or thought and you're like, I got to put that in. So what would justify making that scene? And you have to build outward.
Yeah, awesome. Thank you.
Is there some place where people can see your films?
Yes. creativeinletfilms.com.
Anyway, don't even need a graphic.
I know.
Can anybody hear me or not?
We can all hear you, Kitty. I saw you were unmuted. Carry on.
Okay, I'm so sorry. I was trying to get that guy before he left. I wanted to tell both of them that I was very impressed on what I saw, and I really appreciated you all being here, both of you.
Well, thank you much. Myth's been a big part of my film life, so I appreciate being here just to hang out with you guys.
Well, we appreciate you being here. Thank you.
Thank you.
And there's another Myth movie coming up from TL, this coming Myth.
Let's hope
there.
So.
It's going to get accepted. I don't think the list has been officially released yet, but it made the cut, so it'll be there.
Well, I'm always hopeful, and you know, I tell people, like, I don't care about nominations or wins. To get in is the win. So to get accepted to a festival that's what makes me overflow, and I'm so glad to get in and go. And I try to submit to festivals that I can attend. I mean, not all of them, but obviously I'm not super rich, just minorly rich. But you know, Myth is close, I can go. So I'm gonna always submit, hope to get in and show up.
Yeah.
And a tip about that, when you are submitting to festivals, I learned this lesson kind of the hard way. Look at the types of movies that festival really focuses on, and submit to festivals that, if your movie is a comedy and it's a short, you know, kind of focus on festivals that really like those kind of movies. And don't be discouraged when you get rejected, and look at it positively, because if you get a number of acceptances, like you get 60% rejections and 40% acceptances, that can be pretty good depending on the kind of movie you've got. And I made a mistake years back of something that actually got accepted in two or three festivals, but rejected by three festivals, something like that. And I was really bummed. I looked at the rejections and didn't look at the acceptances. Look at the acceptances in this case.
Yeah, you have to have a tough skin, and just, I totally ignore rejections. I get a rejection, delete, I don't care.
I should have done that. I didn't. I dwelt on it and I said, and I stopped submitting the piece. So,
it's hard to believe that you would ever get a rejection. Have you really had rejections?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Yes, yes. For good reason.
The weird thing is, like, sometimes, yeah, I can be a pretty good gauge of my films. Like, I always think every film I do is like, oh, this is a good one. But in retrospect, like, no, I know that this film of mine is better than this one. But like Body Hackers over here, I was really surprised at this one festival it didn't get into, because I was like, I think Body Hackers is pretty strong and it fits them, but it didn't get into that one. So that one might have hurt a little bit. But another film got in, so I'm still going. But so it's odd sometimes. You're like, wait a minute, I know that this film of mine's better than that one, and that one got in, but why not this? You know. So don't even worry about why you got rejected. Just delete.
Anyone else? We have, before we violate our hour and a half limit, our 30 minutes of discussion, we've got 4 minutes left. I'm staying very much on schedule. Anybody else?
Anybody? Sandy?
Well, actually, so TL, what would we have to do, you know, like talking about in the future when this COVID thing is like not here? What would we do to be able to get you to maybe come to a real life meeting and maybe show one of your shorts or something? And not your shorts. I know you're a comedy person, so you might show us your shorts. That's not what I'm saying. Show us a short film and, you know, then explain the reasoning, how you did the film, you know, that particular film.
Well,
I think it'd be excellent.
It's a long, involved process of just asking.
Oops, yes, I forgot to push the button.
No, I love coming over there and hanging out with you guys at MIF. And, you know, I've not done any B-fit. Is that what it's called, B-fit?
Just face it, it's B-fat.
Okay, B-fat. I was really thrilled to get this email to be here tonight. And I would love to come out and hang out and talk shop. That's the thing is I love to do at film festivals is to go attend, appear, and rub elbows with other filmmakers and talk shop. So I'm there.
That would be awesome. That would be totally awesome.
Thank you. And hearing no other questions, I'm going to share my screen that says thank you to everybody. I think this was a very educational meeting. It showed you some really good ideas that we can learn from and hopefully put to use. I know sometimes time and money limits to what we can do in these things, but given the proper planning ahead, we can make use of some pretty good ideas and I think make our images better. So I thank everyone on behalf of BFAT, which I think is a really cute name. Glad you are all here.
It's memorable. Let's just face it. Everybody remembers our name.
Yep. And I'm working to be a full-fledged member. I've been drinking a lot of beer lately, so I think I might be catching up and be full-fledged member of BFAT. So thank you. And next month, another online meeting. It'll be starting at 6:30, the second Monday of November. So
we have October here before we get to November.
All right. Then let's call it October. I'm ahead
of
the
October 11th.
October 11th. Thank you, Sandy. All right. And I'm going to turn it back to Sandy in case there's anything else that she has to say. And I'm done. Thank you.
I just want to say a great big thank you again to TL. And of course, I could say it to Kevin. He won't hear it. But thank you, Kevin.
thank you
very much for coming, TL.
I was
and are we supposed to call you TL? Is that what you go?
I've gone by TL since fifth grade.
Okay, so toll is not accepted?
Sure, as long as you're buying.
By the way, that was just so excellent, everything. It was really, really good. And I especially liked your film about the person who had Alzheimer's, that personal experience. So it was very touching.
Okay, I have stopped.